Good morning. We would like to welcome you all with us this morning here at the church and on our Facebook and YouTube channel. So we're just so glad that you are able to be a part of our worship today. Youth, just plan on Wednesday, you will still meet in the Big Orange at 6:30, and we are still going strong with 16 kids at our Children's Wednesday Day Camp, so that is going great. They will be going swimming this Wednesday afternoon, so parents got all the information that they will need for that, but just remember, we will be going swimming this Wednesday afternoon. Deacons, there will be a deacons meeting next Sunday at 5 o'clock, so if you will make arrangements to be here for that deacons meeting, that would be great. And again, we are so glad that you are here to worship with us. At this time, I'm going to call on Derek Green.
I just want to let y'all know that we will be having a called church conference next Sunday night at 6:30. It'll be here in the sanctuary, plenty of room spread out and all that. There'll be two really important things that will be coming to you next Sunday night in the conference. We'll have the new budget for the financial year. There are copies of that budget proposal at each of the doors for those of you who are online. Copies of that will be available in the church office during regular office hours this week. And the deacons will also be presenting a revised job description for Alice. And I'm not going to talk you through that right now because we want this to be our worship time. But the short version is that some of Kathy's old community ministry responsibilities, we want to reassign those to Alice. And so copies of that job description are available at each of the doors. Again, those of you online, you can get one of those from the church. And I think that I'm right to say if you can't come over to the church, you can get in touch with Magic. He can email you a copy of that too, so you can see what you're looking at. We'll discuss both the budget and that revised job description in that conference next Sunday night.
Also, a reminder, on the 20th, we will be feeding our Gardner Webb football team in the Family Life Building. If you would like to help with that, you can see myself or Brian or Eric. We will be having a worship service following our regular worship service for the football team following our service that day, and then we will be feeding them lunch. At this time, I'm also going to call on Glenda Green.
Last week, and asked him if I could please have a moment to talk a little bit to you about something, our teachers, and have a special prayer for our teachers this year. Our nurses and doctors are on the front line, as always, but our teachers right now have stepped up to also take that responsibility. Our students are back in school, our teachers are doing things, we're all doing things we've never done before. No telling how much longer we'll have to keep doing them. Our teachers are driving buses. Those buses, you have to wear your mask. The students are wearing the mask from sometimes 6:30 in the morning till 3:30 in the afternoon. Can't take them off except at lunchtime. They're using planning periods to get up and clean up trash because the custodians, they have children with problems. They're taking their students to lunch, getting their lunch, taking them back to the classroom. They have 25 minutes for their student to eat, take off their mask, and back at it they go. And only they can remove their mask for these 25 minutes. And I found something that I'm going to share. It is not written by a teacher from Cleveland County, but it does talk about exactly the situation our teachers are in. I've been quiet this week, mostly because I've been exhausted. Not just tired, but so exhausted that I can hardly make home. And in my 9 years of teaching, I have never been so tired. And I'm not alone. This is commonplace among teachers in this county. What is being asked of us under this hybrid model is not sustainable. In light of this, I'd like to debunk some myths I've heard this week from our own experience, and I purposely stayed quiet, until I could truly provide perspective on all of these. Go home and sleep. That's laughable. Teaching this hybrid model means we're planning lessons that work for students face-to-face and those off-weekers watching virtually at the same time, as well as translate for those who are entirely virtual and who never see in person at all. We have not been given enough time to do this during our particular day. So, we're working way into the wee hours of the morning, unless we fall asleep. Just throw the lessons online, don't worry about it. There's no such thing as throwing it online. Think of the coolest situation or activity you did while you were in school. Does that translate to a computer? It can take hours to rework one lesson, and everything that must be changed and adapted in order for it to translate is the setting, and we're working around the clock to make this happen. Bonus, some teachers teach more than one subject, so we're doing that work multiplied by two or three. Many high school teachers do have three preps that they must make in order to get their classes taught. Teachers are dividing work. At some schools, this is possible, and I'm so glad that these teachers are getting relief. But it is not that way in all schools, especially in high schools. Many high school courses are electives, only taught by one teacher in the building, and scheduling conflicts prevent us from combining classes. Bonus, well, that's an administrative problem. False. My administrators are amazing, and they recognize our struggles. And no, I was not told to say that, but that's happening also. But their hands are tied. They can't give us all that we need. They can't add more time on to us. Only the school board in the state of North Carolina could help out. Teachers are lazy, selfish, just want a day off. Oh, this is my favorite one. We need a virtual day to address the needs of our virtual students who will never see the face of anybody in person. We are all working 10 plus hours each day. It takes an hour or more simply to create, to copy and to paste the assessment into our LMS, an hour. And that's where I really have it created. We're not getting ahead. We're barely keeping our noses above water. We're working for hours on end, and many of us have yet to grade anything because we have no time. Our time is consumed by creating valuable content that works in all of these settings. There's not enough hours in the day. I have a running to-do list in my head that is constantly growing and never shrinking. We as a whole are breaking. I have never seen so many amazingly talented and experienced teachers breaking down in tears on a daily basis, questioning their abilities, their effectiveness, and even if they could continue teaching. Practice self-care. Ha-ha. We're all neglecting our families and ourselves in a way we've never done before. If something doesn't give, we as teachers drop like flies because we've worked ourselves sick. And my favorite, teachers just don't want to go to work. That one hits hard. No teacher I've ever met or would dispute the student wanting to learn more than I do. I love the social, the emotional, the academic needs are better met face-to-face setting. There's nothing about what I do that makes me happier than seeing my kids' faces. I belong in the classroom, and I don't necessarily want to be virtual, even if that's what the health department advises right now. But something has to give, and only our county leaders can change it. So before you criticize your child's teacher, or your friends who are teachers, or tell them just to suck it up and deal with it, please know that they've hit a wall, and it's only 2 weeks into the school year. Check on your teacher friends. We are not only okay, and many of us so far are okay, and we're staying not to try to worry ourselves, but to love our kids and teach them.
Thank you, Linda. We appreciate that. I know that Linda has a very special place in her heart for our teachers, and we do too. But I do know that there are a lot of folks that are hurting in this time, a lot of folks that are really in need of peace. And so right now I'm going to ask you if you would join me in a time of prayer as we seek God's blessing upon students, upon teachers, and really upon every person who's stressed out in this time. Let's pray together, okay? Father, we thank you that in our moments of stress, in our moments, Lord, when our souls are uneasy, you speak peace. And God, we come to you and we seek the blessing that you have to offer on the students of our community, of our county, of our state, of our nation. And Lord, we pray for every teacher who gives so much of themselves to enhance the lives of those students they work with. God, we realize that there are many workers, many people in various disciplines of life who are really struggling right now. We struggle because we don't know all of the answers, but we do know the one who holds all the answers. So Lord, we pray that we might rely on you fully, that God, we might turn our lives toward you, that our hearts, our minds, our eyes, our ears would be focused in on what you have to say to us. God, we love you. Thank you for loving us and for bringing us to this place spiritually. Help us, Lord, to take advantage of these moments when we can look to you as our source of hope and help. We lift this in all prayer in Jesus' holy and wonderful name. Amen. Well, I hope you'll join us now in this time when we worship our Lord together. He wants us to worship him. That's so important for us. So this morning, part of our worship is a time we call koinonia. It's a time of fellowship. I want to encourage you just to stand where you're at, wave at one another, and welcome each other into God's house this morning. Let's all stand and greet one another.
The scripture this morning comes from Exodus chapter 14. And when Pharaoh drew near, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them, and they were sore afraid. And the children of Israel cried unto the Lord. And they said unto Moses, because there were no graves in Egypt, hast thou taken us away to die in the wilderness? Wherefore hast thou dealt thus with us, to carry us forth out of Egypt? Is this not the word that we did tell thee in Egypt, saying, let us alone, that we may serve the Egyptians? For it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness. And Moses said unto the people, fear ye not, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show to you today. For the Egyptians, whom you have seen today, you shall see them again no more forever. The Lord shall fight for you, and you shall hold your peace. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for a beautiful day. Thank you that your people can come together and can worship you. And Lord, we pray that you would teach us to stand still and to watch you deliver us and to know that it was your hand that did it. Lord, we pray that you would take the offerings that are given this morning and that you would bless them and that you would multiply them and that you would do more with them than we could ever imagine. And we pray these things in Jesus' name, amen.
Situations that tug of war at me all day long, I struggle for the answers that I need, but then I come into his presence, all my questions become clear. a place for us to rest, a place to find the answers in the hour of distress. There is never any reason for you to give up in
Last night, I stood with a father whose son, a 15-year-old, was killed in a car wreck. And we prayed. And last night, I stood with about 20 firefighters and EMS workers and highway patrolmen. And they realized that the situation they found themselves in was out of their control. And we prayed. And last night, I stood with the people who were involved in the accident, knowing it wasn't their fault that things happened the way that they did. And it seemed as though they were overwhelmed by the situation, but we prayed. And what we were seeking was the peace of God, the presence of Jehovah. I'm telling you that when we come into the most difficult moments of our lives, our greatest refuge is our God. And if we want to experience the power of God in our lives, we must experience first the presence of God in our lives. And in order for us to experience the presence of God, we need to make a habit of spending time in silence and solace, just listening. You may say to me, "Pastor, that's impossible for me. My job is too demanding. My children are too demanding. My wife, my husband, they want more from me than I can give right now. Everything that I hear in the news overwhelms me. The present world situation, I don't know if I can tolerate it anymore. I don't know how to handle my life any longer. I don't know if I can seek the presence of God." And the truth is, we all have hectic lifestyles. Every one of us here is experiencing some kind of stress in our lives. Maybe you're not the one who lost a child yesterday. Maybe you're not the one who has been dealing with the effects of COVID-19. Maybe you're not the one who has been terribly offended by all of the hatred in the world that's being projected these days. But my guess is that we all have been affected. I was talking to somebody the other day, and we were talking about all of the speech that's coming either politically or from civil unrest. There's so much hatred in the world. There's so much pressure that's coming to us through the effects of the pandemic and the political elections that are coming up. This guy looked at me and he said, "Anybody who doesn't have high blood pressure simply isn't paying attention. You're just not listening." And maybe that's the point. Maybe that's the point in all of this. Maybe we are too much in tune with the earthly, and we haven't got our ears and our hearts and our eyes focused enough on the heavenly. Maybe it's time for us just to surrender who we are and what we want and begin to speak those words that King David spoke when he said, "I have stilled and quieted my soul." In Psalm 46, God says to us, "Be still and know that I am God." The first thing that we need to do in order to be in the presence of God is just stop. Stop what you're doing and just begin to breathe. And as you are breathing, realize that every breath that you take and every heartbeat that takes place within your chest comes as a gift from God. When we can just slow down and we can begin to consume the goodness of God rather than being consumed by the hate of the world, things will begin to come into perspective. I'm telling you that each day we need to slow down and give God what is right, not what's left over, but give God what is right. What comes first, give to God. David wrote, "I wait for the Lord. My soul waits, and in His word I put my hope." Where's your hope right now? You know, if you've placed your hope in the next election, good luck. Good luck. I've been around for a while. I've been around the block a few times. And I'm going to tell you that whoever gets elected isn't going to do a very good job. Now, I may have offended somebody right there. But all you have to do is look at history. And all you have to do is watch the campaign, all the ads. No matter who's in office, they're doing a horrible job. And the next person who's running for office is going to guarantee us they're going to do a great job. But the next time the election rolls around, they did a horrible job. If we put our faith in men, if we put our faith in organizations, we are missing the great blessing of putting our faith in our Creator, the one who knows us, the one who grows us, the one who stands strong for us. It's true, there's a lot to be anxious about in the world today. There's a lot to be anxious about today, which means that you and I have an awful lot to surrender to God. If you think about peace and how you find peace, the way we find peace is by surrendering ourselves and our problems and our situations. We find peace when there is an absence of anxiety. And this world will cause you to be anxious. All you got to do is turn on the news for 5 minutes. I mean, my blood pressure, Wanda, I'm calling you out, baby. Wanda called me the other day and she said, "Preacher, my blood pressure's out the roof. I need you to be praying for me. Do an all call." I did an all call. We've been praying for you. But I'm going to tell you, in these days, anybody whose blood pressure isn't high, it's a little strange. How do we get that blood pressure low? How do we get it where it needs to be? We need to trust in the one who's created us. We need to be able to lay our burden down. And we can lay our burden down when we seek hope and help in our God. David said, "O Israel, put your hope in the Lord, both now and forevermore." Today I want to share with you a beautiful psalm. It's a very short psalm, but it's so beautiful because it articulates exactly what we need to be doing today. Every one of us, if you're hearing this message, God has designed this moment for a reason. I don't think that there are any mistakes. I don't think there are any coincidences. I believe that God designs moments, and I believe that this is a designed moment for you. Whether you're right here with us personally or whether you're watching on your computer, however it is you're hearing this message, God wants to speak to you today. So hear these words that come from the psalmist. Psalm 131. "My heart is not proud, O Lord. My eyes are not haughty. I do not concern myself with great matters or things too wonderful for me. But I have stilled and quieted my soul like a weaned child with its mother. Like a weaned child is my soul within me. O Israel, put your hope in the Lord, both now and forevermore. David understood. He understood that in order for us to experience a calm spirit, certain things had to happen. And I don't know about you, maybe you are walking around very anxious about everything, but isn't it time for you to let go of your anxiety and experience the calm spirit that God wants you to experience? David says, I have stilled and quieted my soul like a weaned child with its mother. Like a weaned child is my soul within me. There it is. There it is. That's the answer. If you want to have a calm spirit, think about a mother and a child that is not nursing. For you ladies who have had children, you understand what I'm talking about. Many of you fathers understand what I'm talking about. But when you have a little bitty baby, there are a couple of things they're really, really good at. One of them is using the bathroom, and the other one is consuming food. They're real good at that. Now, there's another thing that they're real good at, and it's letting you know when they're hungry. They'll start crying in the middle of the night. They won't even let you get good sleep. They're not considerate at all. It's about them. When they're hungry, they're hungry. And they're going to cry out for mom to come and feed them or for dad to come and take care of them. And they're so anxious because they're not sure if they're going to get that next meal or not. And so they begin to cry out, mom. Of course, they don't speak like we speak, but they're crying out. And they're wanting mom or dad to come and comfort them. Most of the time, comfort comes in the form of milk, mother's milk. And as they're eating, I love this because as a grandfather, as a father and as a grandfather, I've seen this many times when our grandsons would be eating or drinking, and after they get through, they just go and they fall out. We call it a milk drunk at our house. That's a milk drunk. But it's so wonderful to see because they were so anxious and they were crying out, and all of a sudden, every need that they have, every need that they can comprehend is taken care of. But do you know what's even more beautiful than that? It's whenever you have a child that gets old enough that they're no longer breastfeeding, or they no longer take a bottle, but they climb up into mom or dad's lap and they're just content being there. You know why they're content? Because they know that mom and dad are not going to fail them, that mom and dad are going to make sure that every need they have is taken care of, that when they're hungry, food will be provided. And that's the way our relationship ought to be with God. We don't have to be anxious for anything. If we want a calm spirit, we need to think of ourselves as children who have been weaned. And we are, because we love God, want to climb up into God's lap and just hold tightly to Him. Yesterday, my oldest grandson, and his parents too, came to visit with us just for a little while. And when they drove up, Boo, my little grandson, is able to get out of his car seat, and he gets out of the car and he sees me. I'm down in the woods and he sees me and he's running to me with arms open wide. Poppy, Poppy! There's nothing better. There's nothing better. That calms my spirit. But what was so neat was when he ran and grabbed me, and I lifted him up, he wrapped his arms around me, and he wasn't going to let me go. Not until Mimi walked out the door. Then Mimi walks out the door and blows that moment for me because he sees Mimi. Mimi, Mimi. I think I'm everything to him until Mimi walks out. But it just reminds me how we ought to run to God. God, Jehovah, Yahweh, Lord. And our love ought to be so immense for our God that we wrap our arms around Him because He wants to wrap His arms around us. I'll tell you, I know He wants to wrap His arms around you today. He wants you to climb up into His lap. He wants you to lay your burden down. He wants you to enjoy the moment that you have with Him. Viktor Frankl was a Jew who lived during World War II. He found himself in a concentration camp, and out of that experience, he wrote an astounding book. I hope that if you've never read it, that you'll take time to read it. It's called Man's Search for Meaning, and in that book, he talks about his experience as a Jew. His experience being in a concentration camp, being in a place where there was no hope and no help perceived coming. And Frankl worked in a hospital, if you'll call it that, maybe for the other Jewish people in that concentration camp. Just outside of the infirmary which he worked, there was a tent pitched. It was a shelter built. And you would think the shelter would be there for a helpful purpose, but the only reason the shelter was there was so that the dead bodies that were coming from this infirmary wouldn't decay so quickly. And Frankl says that the only time he could ever find peace and solitude were those moments when he would walk outside of the infirmary and sit among the dead bodies under the shelter. He said that he would find himself in a state of mind when he would look over the landscape and it was so beautiful, and he would be reminded of God's graciousness and His presence. And he said the only thing that would disturb that is the marching of the German soldiers as they would come by with new patients. No matter where you are, no matter what your life circumstance, God has a place of peace for you. A place of solitude for you to experience, but you've got to desire that. This song of ascent that David wrote uses the imagery of a weaned child. You can only imagine yourself being like that, knowing that God is going to take care of you and desiring to be in His presence. We all long for a calm spirit. We all long for the peace of God, a peace that passes human understanding. Let me tell you, each one of us, every one of us, if we want to experience peace, then we've got to listen more than we talk. Quite often we think that prayer is about how much we can say to God, how much we can lift up our needs to God, how much we can lay on God. God bless me with this. God help me to let go of that. Sometimes the greatest communication is not when we are talking, but when we are listening. Are you listening to God? Are you taking time to really listen to God? Psalm 62, David says, "My soul waits in silence for God. From Him is my salvation." My soul waits in silence for Him. We don't have to feel as though we've got to fill every moment with words. And we don't have to worry about articulating in a beautiful way some prayer to God. He knows your heart. He knows your mind. Speak to God as you would a friend, and allow God to respond to you as a friend would. The first thing we have to do if we want to experience a calming of our spirit is to let go of ourselves. Oh, I'm going to tell you, pride gets in the way of so many things, but a relationship with God, oh, there's no room for pride if you're in a relationship with God. God calls us to come before Him with a humble heart. God calls us to come to Him, laying all of our burdens and all of our thoughts down and allowing Him just to speak to us. I don't know about you, but I have to take medicine. And I'm thankful that they make medicine the way they do. They put this waxy coating on the outside of medicine. And that way it's, you know, at least you can swallow it and you don't have to taste the horrible taste of the medicine. And God's message to us is a lot like a tablet. It's covered on both ends with this idea that God has got an answer in the middle. Look at the very first part of that scripture. My heart is not proud. My eyes are not haughty. I don't concern myself with great matters or things that are too wonderful for me. That's part of the coding. And then you get to the meat of the idea that God wants us to understand. I've got to have a stilled and quiet soul, like a weaned child with its mother. And then David says, "Oh Israel, put your trust in God. Let go of yourself. Let go of your pride." I read years ago in Nelson's, someone once said this quote, "Did you notice how we shook that bridge?" A flea said to the elephant that he was riding on as they crossed over an old bridge. Did you hear that? Did you notice how much we shook that bridge? The flea said to the elephant as they walked across an old bridge. It had nothing to do with the flea. But he wanted to take credit for shaking the bridge. And quite often in our lives, things will happen and we want to take credit for it. It has nothing to do with us. It has absolutely nothing to do with us except if we give God the glory for it. We can be used as His instruments, but so often pride gets in the way. Let me tell you, all through history, pride has gotten in the way of people doing great things for God. Bud Robinson said, "Pride's the only disease known to man that makes everyone sick except the one who has it." Alexander White said, "It is out of self-love that all other evil passions spring." William Barclay said, "Pride is the ground in which all other sins grow." Benjamin Whichcote said, "None are so empty as those who are full of themselves." Think about it. Someone once said, "A man wrapped up in himself makes a pretty small package." Pride gets in the way. It gets in the way of relationships we have with each other, but it really gets in the way of the relationship we could share with our God. Let me just tell you that we don't have room for pride when we have God in our lives. There was a bumper sticker I saw not long ago, and it said, "There are two unchangeable truths. First of all, there is a God. Second of all, you are not Him." But we want to be. We want to be God. We're so full of ourselves that we don't have room for God. But if we want to have the power of God, we need to have the presence of God in our lives. Our hope is in the Lord and the Lord only. If you look in your Bibles, especially in sections like this, you're going to see the name Lord capitalized all the way throughout. And that's just the way that the Hebrews acknowledged the greatness of God. This is Yahweh. This is Jehovah. And so today, I want to encourage you to come into the presence of Jehovah by surrendering yourself and experiencing His peace. Today, would you? Would you lay down that pride? Would you pick up His mercy? Would you come before Him and just bow down your life? This morning we want to offer to you an invitation. The invitation is for you to make a decision to follow Him. And if maybe you've never done that, I would love for you to know my Jesus. Oh, He's so wonderful. He's so good. My God, the God that I serve, He is full of mercy and grace. And I want to offer that God to you. This morning we sing a hymn of invitation. Maybe you realize that the relationship you once had with God has been broken or drifted away. It's time to come back home. And maybe today you just want to be a part of this church family. We encourage you to come as God speaks to your spirit. Let's all stand and we'll sing together. So glad that you were here today. I hope that you have a wonderful weekend. But in this time, I hope that you'll take a moment just to be in the presence of Jehovah. Allow Him to penetrate your heart and, Lord, just to lead your life. And so I'm going to ask Brandon if he'll close us in prayer, and then we will be dismissed. Looking for peace, Lord. I just pray that you will bring them closer to you, because that's where it starts.